164. Paul, if I don't know it, you're coming down to sing it, right? There is a green hill far away without a city wall. Which chorus, which verse, which tune are we going to sing that one? The original, okay. Okay, Paul, I hear you. 164. There is a green hill. Is that the original, Paul? I know like four versions. Is that the one?
Where the dear Lord was crucified, who died to save us all. We may not know.
What a beautiful cross that was and still is in our hearts and in our lives today. I invite us to stand at this time.
Gathering his name. coming to his house, gathering his name to worship Christ the Lord, worshiping Jesus Christ the Lord. Let's forget about ourselves, concentrate on him and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves, concentrate on him and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves, concentrate on him and worship Christ the Lord. Concentrate on him and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves. Concentrate on him and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves. Concentrate on him and worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Jesus Christ the Lord.
So
let us worship him, Jesus Christ the Lord. Let us worship him, Jesus Christ the
now we gather where the Master makes us one, where we worship God the Father through the Spirit of His Son. All who search for His church find it where His will is done. Precious is the tie that binds us. He is still our safe stronghold. Faithful love serves to prove. Here's a shepherd as his fold. May we learn from Christ's example how to use this house of prayer. He who loved and cleansed his temple wants us all to worship there. God the Son shuts out none. In his kingdom all may share. Lord, inspire us with your vision of a world which must be one. Glorious is the church mission, long endeavors, cares begun. Faithful now, this is how God's eternal will is. We will continue to worship the Lord in his holy temple.
I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise his holy name. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to thank the Lord. I just came to thank the Lord. I just came to praise his holy name. I just came to thank the Lord. I just came to love the Lord. I just came to love the Lord. I just came to praise his holy name. I just came to love the Lord. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise his holy name. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise the Lord. I just came to praise the Lord.
Father, we have gathered today a body of believers. Lord, we are staking our claim to your promises. And so we've come into this building knowing that we are going to continue in your presence. And so, Father, we ask today that you'll pour out your Holy Spirit without measure. We know you're concerned for our needs. We know you're concerned for even our wants and our desires. You're concerned, Lord, about everything regarding us. And so we praise your holy name. We lift your name on high. And we open up our minds, our hearts, our very being to you today. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Please be seated.
Iglesia y feliz sábado. Para los visitantes, bienvenidos aquí al Casa del Señor. Si ustedes están buscando una área para orar al Señor, aquí encuentran su hogar. Que Dios les bendiga y que tengan feliz sábado. Y si ustedes son visitantes, por favor, pónganse a pie para que nuestro pastor les pueda dar una bienvenida. Muchas gracias.
Les amis, bonjour et bon sabbat. Nous voulons, au nom des pasteurs de l'Église, Dr. Roylet et Pasteur Campbell, nous voulons souhaiter à ceux qui nous visitent ce matin et dont les langues maternelles sont le français et le créole, leur souhaiter la plus cordiale des bienvenues et que ce moment passé en compagnie de notre Créateur vous soit favorable. Encore une fois, bon sabbat et bienvenue dans le Seigneur.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. Welcome to Lehigh SDA. As we're making you welcome today, I'd like you to consider the pearl of great price, which the merchantman sold all that he had to obtain. Christ gave heaven and everything to obtain us. We, every one of us, we are his pearl of great price. May we in turn give everything that we have to obtain him. It's a gift, but we have to give everything that we have to obtain him. He is our great pearl, our pearl of great price. To our regular pearls who are here from week to week, Sabbath to Sabbath, welcome. Do we have any visiting pearls today? First time visitors, second time visitors, welcome. And I heard earlier that we have some visitors who come from time to time, like Sister Gordon, who is here, welcome. And Naylen and Nayeli and other visitors who come from time to time. You will be individually and specially welcomed now by Pastor Campbell.
All right. Well, we have some visitors. Yes. How you doing, my dear? May I give you a hug? You look like you needed a hug just then. Amen. We welcome you. Tell us your name and where you're hailing from.
Genevieve Jinjax from Miami, Florida. Of Jeffrey Jinjax.
Amen. The mother, that's where he gets his strength? Yes? Yes? Amen. We love you. We're glad you're here with us. Amen? Amen. Want to head back? Did I pick that mic? My dear brother, we shook hands earlier, but I didn't get a name or a place, so give me some of your vitals.
Brother Hunt, from Brooklyn.
All the way from Brooklyn. I mean, like, you don't live in Lehigh and you're still claiming Brooklyn, is that?
Yeah, well, I claim Lehigh and Brooklyn.
All right, he fixed it up. Who brought you here today?
Elder Wonder.
Elder Wonder brought you here today. Elder Wonder, you inviting folk to church? Amen. Elder Wonder said, I'm inviting folk to church. Amen. We welcome you here, and we pray that God will richly bless you in the fellowship you experience here. Amen. Am I There's somebody, see, you were trying to hide out there, brother. See, nothing much. How you doing? You smell good. You're looking good. Amen. Can I get you to stand up and tell us your name and where you're hailing from? They set him up. I had nothing to do with it. You know who did it, right? You know who the culprits are? I'm pointing at them right now. All right, don't worry.
The time is coming. Good night. All right. Good morning and happy Sabbath to everybody. My name is Steve Hunt. I'm from Flatbush. Anybody here from Flatbush? Okay. Flatbush.
Amen. We have New Yorkers with us today. Now, I saw somebody on this side. Was there a first-time visitor on this side? We don't want to miss anybody. Well, if we haven't missed anybody, I wonder if we could stand at this time and sing Everybody Smile and give somebody a loving smile. We have somebody? All right, hold on. Yeah? You all were waiting for me. Come on over here. Come hang out with me for 2 seconds. Can we keep playing? Start playing Smile for us. We're going. We have 2 young people. Do you guys know the Smile song? Everybody Smile? Yeah, tell us your name.
Naylin.
You're Naylin? And how old are you, Naylin?
5.
You're 5? My goodness, you make me feel really, All right, and your name?
Naily.
And how old are you, Naily?
I'm 7.
And where you guys live? One more time, they didn't hear you. You're a long way away. Who are you visiting? You forgot who you're visiting? Who are you going home with? Just point. All right, you got it. Go ahead, tell us.
Grandma.
Amen. Well, we welcome you here today, all right? And I might even find it. Oh, no, I don't have a gift with me, but I'm going to give Grandma a gift to send to you, okay? Blessings. All right, let us stand as we sing. Smile, everybody, smile. Let us greet somebody in Jesus' name.
Smile.
Let us greet somebody in Jesus' name. Let us tell them that you love them in Jesus' name. Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile, Jesus loves you.
Smile,
everybody smile. Everybody smile, everybody smile.
Smile, everybody smile. Everybody smile, everybody smile. Won't you greet somebody in Jesus' name? Won't you tell them that you love them in Jesus' name? Tell them we can work together in Jesus' name. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile. Jesus loves you. Everybody smile, everybody smile, everybody smile. Smile, everybody smile, everybody smile, everybody smile.
Amen. Don't you feel so much better when you've been greeted in Jesus' name? You've been greeted with all kind of things all week long. But today you've been greeted in Jesus' name. I believe where 2 or 3 are gathered, the power of God is there. I think we're on full power. What would you say? Amen. We have some birthdays to celebrate. And before we do that, I want to welcome Sister Gordon. Sister Gordon, she's still busy greeting people. Sister Gordon. How you doing? You just so happy to be back in Lehigh. We got to do one more round of everybody smile just for Sister Gordon. We want to welcome you home, Sister Gordon. And we understand you're going right on back to London, to Watford. Anybody know Watford? Yes? And that's up there toward where the union office is. And so take our love back with you. We're not jealous because you'll be here next week. Amen. But we won't be jealous because it's cold in London. Amen. In Watford, too. You getting some sunshine. Store it up now. Store it up. Store it up. Don't you just love Sister Gordon? Amen. We have some birthdays today, quite a bit of birthdays, the rest of January and the beginning of February. And I wonder how many people we actually have. You know, we have some wonderful gifts for you. Amen. I still haven't opened it up to see what this gift is. So is today the day I need to open up and see what it is we're giving to people? Nobody won't tell me. Anybody know what this is? It's a mirror. So you can take a good look at yourself and decide you're going to do better. Amen? I'm going to keep my mirror. You know, I'm determined to do better. Amen? Help me, Jesus. So we have Evelyn May Smith, 126. This is Evelyn May. Are you here? Amen. Come on up. I'm gonna call everybody up because I realize if I give you your gift too early, you take off. So we're gonna get Sister Janet Thomas. Is Sister Thomas here today? Yeah? Come on up. Come on down. We have Maria Paldino. Maria, is Maria here? She's sick on her birthday. Her birthday was the 26th as well. Please give her your love if you have her number. Make sure you give her a call. We have Denzel Green. Brother Denzel here. Birthday 127. Make sure you give him a call if you have his number. Encourage him along. You know, I hear people, they get upset when the church doesn't. Nobody in the church remember their birthday. Not none of y'all here. But call somebody. Their birthday means something to them. Amen? Amen. And tell them the pastor says hello too. We have Angelica Lynn Dubois. Is Angelica here? Not here. Give her a call. Wish her 129 was her birthday. Roger Hamilton. Amen. Come on up. There he is. No, he's right here. He knew his birthday. He wasn't going to miss his gift. Come on up. Two more. And I know where Genevieve is because I looked on Facebook. So everybody on Facebook, y'all know where Genevieve is, right? Amen. I'm happy for her and Bruce. They deserve the trip. Amen. I'm not going to give you all their information. You have to go on Facebook and look for yourself if they friended you. And finally, but last but not least, Michael Mayers on February 1st. Come on down. Come on, Michael. If I have to look at these mirrors, you do too. Let me give out some mirrors. Michael, what took you so long, man? You're the youngest of the bunch. Here you go. Let's sing happy birthday to our brothers and sisters.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
The hostage situation has ended. You can go back to your seats. We love you. We do have two anniversaries at the end of December. At the end of January, we'd like to acknowledge. That's Attila and Sasha Kiss. I know I saw both of them today, and they're both smiling. Well, Attila was smiling earlier. Amen. Amen. And if you ever talk to either one of them, you know they're a lively bunch. Come on down. Come on down. And we also have Jean and Gracious Louis. Are they here today? Hey, pass the word on that we wanted to acknowledge their anniversary on 131, January 31st. So we only have one couple walking the aisle today. Come on. Walk it like you walked it how many years ago? Look at her, she's just smiling away. Who gives this woman to be wed? Come on now. Just in case. All right, that was beautiful. How many years, you know, we're going to ask you, so I hope you were prepared. How many years, months, days, hours, minutes, seconds, milliseconds? Count and counting. Get as close as you can, bro.
17 years and 5 days.
All right. Is he right? Is he correct? You were going to say that anyway, because y'all kind of close, okay? Let's sing happy anniversary to this lovely couple here. Can we do that today? And wish them well. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, dear. Happy anniversary to you. You may now kiss the bride. All right. God bless you. Let us continue to worship God today in the beauty of his holiness. I want to acknowledge the Jacques family who are here today. And only one word comes to mind, bravery, but also healing. And so I pray that worship today with this body of believers brings about a sense of healing or a sense of something that is straight from God. Amen? So we welcome you, we love you, and we're glad that you've chosen to be with us in his presence here in this chosen place. Amen. We're going to invite Sister Hamilton to come with the announcement. While she's coming, after the children's story today, we're going to have a baby blessing. It's never too late to bring a child to the Lord. Amen? And so we'll have that today as we continue. Here we go.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. How long has it been? From last year? Wow. You didn't miss me. Happy New Year. Merry Christmas. Happy 4th of July. All of that. Okay. So it always seems to befall me to have this multitude of announcements. Because I watch online and I never hear this many. It's like everybody was looking for me. So let me get organized. Let's get started. And I'm starting out with tonight, this afternoon, at 5:15. It is Youth Forum. And you know, February 1st, what month is it? Black History Month. And so we're starting a series. And even though I look at it, told me what it was, I'm not going to disclose it to you guys because I want you all to be here. It is something exciting, and it is keeping in tune with Black History Month. So be here, everyone, for this afternoon at 5:15. Then moving on, we have a reminder on Wednesday evenings, because it's 7 o'clock, and it is our Bible study. Some call it prayer meeting, but it is really exciting to be here on Wednesday evening, so come out and support for the midweek refreshment. Now, also this afternoon, the children's choir will be having their rehearsal at 4:30. So 4:30 is the children's choir, so parents bring out the children and then stay for youth forum, right? I'm continuing to plug Youth Forum this evening. Quick reminder also that second grade report, school report, it was due from last week. However, Sister Nadine, who is not here in person, has sent a message that she's extended it for today. So for the children who did not hand in their reports, please do so. Parents, for the little ones, it's your responsibility to get the reports in. So when you bring the children out for choir practice this evening, just bring the reports and you can hand in to any member of the education department, okay? Ushers, you're asked to meet after divine service, immediately after this divine service, and I'm placing you on the organ side. So all ushers meet with Sister Sharon on the organ side. Right now, the Bible Bowl team, they should have left at 11, but when I checked back there, they were still there. They are traveling to Miami for Bible Bowl. The weather is not very nice. We need prayers for them as they journey out, and we need prayers for their success. So remember them as we pray today. I have a long announcement for February 25, but of course, Brother Barrett had to get me. Health and Temperance, it will be a luncheon meeting. The 15th? Okay. He was just happy to see me. He gave me the wrong day. The 15th. So it's a luncheon meeting for the Health and Temperance Department. So come out and support your meeting. All right. So I got everything on that side. And I have here, it is an evening of elegance, fine dining, worship, and fun. And this is from the Church of God of Prophecy of Lehi Acres. You remember the church that used to worship here on Sunday that have their own building now. So they're inviting you to come out this evening. I think this announcement was out here some time ago. I just got it on my first day back. So it will be at Colonial Country Club. And don't want to shock you with the price, but I'll put it out there for you. It is $70, all right? Okay. And I have a card here with us. And Pastor Andre just, the Jacks who are here in church. Words cannot express the way we feel. All the prayers and love is greatly appreciated. It really shows how a church congregation should be in the time of need. It is wonderful how God will bring people in our lives just when you need them. People who will love, support, guide, and most importantly, pray for us. We sincerely appreciate all of your prayers and all of the support that was given in this difficult moment for my family. I know that God always has a final say, and he's never wrong. Princess Malia Grace John Jacks will be in good hands now. Love from the Jacks family. Continue to pray them up as we go on our daily way. And so, I come to the end of our announcements, and I leave with you a thought. I woke up this morning with a song in my heart and on my lips, and I really do sing a lot at home. Don't get any ideas here. So, but nobody was saying to me this morning, I just kept on singing. I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from the sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. And the verse that came out to me was, many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Remember, brethren, that we all know who holds our hand. Have a blessed day.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. The opening hymn is 2A26. Wonderful Words of Life.
Sing them over again to me.
And theme song. The mission of the Lehi Seventh-day Adventist Church is to articulate the life of Christ through its diverse congregation and community outreach by being an active center of faith, hope, worship, and fellowship, and loving service. Open hearts, open arms, and open hands. Theme song.
With open hearts, we come before you now. With open hearts, we embrace your love. With open hands, we touch your face. As we reflect your marvelous grace, reaching the world through the center of faith. Please use us, O Lord. With open hearts, we come before you now. With open arms, we embrace your love. With open hands, we touch your face. As we reflect your marvelous grace, reaching the world through the center of faith, please use us, O Lord.
Please be seated. And the scripture reading for today is from the book of Acts, chapter 20, verse 24. And I'm reading from the book from the version of New King James Version. But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. The word of God. Amen.
morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Please give to the little church so the big church can grow.
Working? Hello? Oh, perfect. Okay. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, boys and girls. Here are about three people. Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning.
Much better. And how are you doing today? Yeah, that's awesome. Are we ready to hear the children's story? What? Are we ready to hear the children's story? Okay. So the story, the title for my story is called Light. What can it be about? Has anyone ever seen this before? Do you know what this is? A highlighter. Good. What do you use a highlighter for?
To highlight the words.
To highlight, like, important things. Actually, what he says.
Okay, good. Anyone else?
Highlight key details.
Ooh, he's getting deep. All right. So highlighters, this is a highlighter. And you know there's different colors of highlighters, red and pink and green or whatnot. Highlighters, okay, that is a good point. Highlighters are an important tool. Students use highlighters when they're studying for what? For a test or for school or whatever they have to do. If you're reading your notes or a book and you come across something that you want to remember, what should you do? Highlight it. Good. Oh, girls, paying attention. Look at me. All right. And then when you go back and study, that important passage will jump out at you because it's a different color, right? Sometimes a person at their job might use a highlighter to mark something they want to what? Remember. Good. Or see. Good point. Or if they're reading a long report for their boss, they might use the highlighter. I'm just trying to see if you're following along. To mark something very important for their boss to see. Can anyone else give me an example of what you'll use your highlighter for? Anyone else?
Whenever a teacher says to highlight this part because it's going to be on your test.
So you can highlight God, like remember him.
As you says.
And you know my story. Okay. All right. Okay, so has anyone ever seen a Bible with highlighting, like highlighters, like your grandpa or grandma or your mom? Have you seen? Raise your hand if you've seen a Bible with highlight. Good. All right, so that can be a very valuable tool for us as we study God's word. If you find a verse that's really meaningful to you, you can highlight it so it will catch your attention and you'll be able to find it again or easier. Good. All right, I like these words. But you know, there's another way we can highlight scriptures in our lives, and that's to memorize it, right? Memorizing is just like highlighting scripture in your heart. When you're feeling down, you can remember a verse about joy. And when you need to resist temptation, you can recall a verse that about standing strong with God. Psalms 119, verse 105 says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path." Just as a highlighter brings the words on a page to light, God's word lights the steps of our lives. Sounds like a good verse to highlight in our hearts, doesn't it? Oh, you guys are not paying attention. Repeat it with me. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. So your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Come on, sing it with me. Here we go. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So you can remember that verse by singing it. So repeat the same verse tonight and every night this week. Then every week, recite that verse at least how much times? One time. Then start memorizing the verse, the other verses that's in the Bible. So the more of God's word you can highlight in your life, the more you will find yourself walking in his light. Amen. Who wants to pray? All right, come on up. Any other person? Okay, we're quiet today. Bow your heads.
Thank God for Furby. Mommy and Daddy, I love you, God. You protect us. I love you, God. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Have a happy Sabbath.
We have a baby blessing today. We want to invite the Harris family to come forward. And little Naylin, you guys remember Naylin? Anybody remember how old Naylin is? Naylin is 5. Did they get it right, Naylin? Come on up, man. Come join with me up here. Are you nervous? I usually don't have babies that can talk, but we can actually have a conversation. Are you nervous?
No.
Good. And your sister's been blessed, and so you're about to join in a special, what can I call it, folks? I don't want to call it a ritual, a special blessing. We just keep it simple. You're going to be blessed today. Is that okay if we bless you today? And Nyla, right? Nayeli, do you mind if your brother joins you and is blessed today? You mind? Okay, I didn't ask that question right. All right, Grandma and Nayeli, you're going to put hands on him today and those who have come. And you're going to hold my hand, and then I'm putting my hand on your head, okay? All right? Don't worry. Your hair will stay in place. But God, through Jesus, his son, when Jesus was here, he didn't turn away little children. He said, "Suffer the little children, let them come unto me." And he often reminded us that the kingdom of heaven is like children. It's like a child. Little children, we must become like little children to enter into the kingdom. And so one thing I learned about children, I didn't learn until I saw a real mustard seed. I was over in Holland and went to where they had the windmills, and the East Indian Spice Company. something like that. And I saw a real mustard seed. And that thing was tiny. But have you ever seen a real mustard tree, a full-grown mustard tree? That thing is humongous. And so I realized, the Holy Spirit said, a child is like a mustard seed. Jesus used both when he was giving an example of faith. And the reality is, if we could have the faith of a mustard seed, if we could have the faith of a child, we can move mountains, right? And so the Holy Spirit said, here it is. Both mustard seeds and children have tremendous growth potential. And so if we want to enter the kingdom of God, we've got to allow our minds to expand and grow. Amen? And this little mind is just getting ready. Amen? What's your favorite Bible verse? I mean, I'm just enjoying this because I don't get to ask babies these questions. Do you have a favorite Bible verse that you like in the Bible?
Yes.
Just put you on the spot, but let's go for it. Help him out, Nayella. All right, he said he's going to come back in a few weeks, and we're going to work that out. I'm going to give you one. John 3:16, repeat after me. For God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. Naylon, you nailed it, okay? You're going to hear that a lot in your life, all right? Let us pray, church. Let's commit to this family as well, even though they live in Texas. Support the grandmother as she is supportive of them and their parents. Amen? Let us pray. Father, today we bless this young life. Lord, he's just learning his colors and his numbers and his letters and all the different things in life that there is to learn, Lord. Father, we pray that he'll learn to put those things together and come to an understanding of who you are. Father, allow him to use this brain that is developing in his body, Father. Allow him to use his very being and understand that he's created for your purposes. And so, Father, we announce this blessing. We pronounce this blessing over his life today. And Father, we know that he is in your hands. We pray for his parents. We pray for his grandparents. We pray for those who will teach him. Father, we just ask that you will bless his going out and his coming in. And Father, when all is said and done, we long that he too will receive life eternal. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Nayla, give me a good handshake. There we go, man. All right, there we go. And we have a gift for you. All right? Amen. And I didn't give his details, but his parents are Alex Aris and Angelica Aris. You all know them. And grandparents, Sister Angela Aris. And date of birth was 12/30/2015. Amen. He was 6 pounds, 14 ounces, 21 inches. He was a long, tall little fella. Born in Dallas, Texas. God bless you. At this time, we're going to continue on with our offertory, followed by praise and worship.
Happy Sabbath to you all. It's time that everybody can participate, whether it's big or small. This is offering time. Before the deacons come forward, I have a story for you. A story is about money in the mattress and not in the church. Anna's uncle was known to be very tight with his money. When he gets his pay, he would take $20 out of it and then put the rest in his mattress. So, of course, his mattress, his wife being on one side and him being on the other side. His side of the mattress getting higher and higher than the wife's. Anyhow, and his uncle got sick. And when he got sick, he realized that he would not survive this illness. So he asked his wife to promise him one thing. And the promise he wanted was for his wife, when he dies, to put the money in the casket with him. Okay? So the wife was very smart. The wife took the money after he died, the money to the bank, put it in the checking account, and then wrote him a check. Guys, don't be like that uncle. Deacon Stan, please. Give back to you. Lord, bless it that he may do your work and we may bring soul to praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures.
Before the praise team sings, there's somebody singing on the praise team today that I understand we won't be seeing for a while. And some of you have no idea who I'm talking about, but that's none other than our music coordinator, Sister Carol Dharma. Amen. Come on up, Sister Carol. Amen. Come on up. Come on up. Come on up, Sister Dharma. I want to thank God for her ministry here at Lehigh. And she's informed me that she's going to be going to Maine. Where's that? That's in the United States, right?
Yes.
I'm just kidding. I know that. How long? I'm going to let you tell all your business. How long are you going to be gone?
Actually, I'm going on a travel assignment for 13 weeks and should be back at the end of April, early May, I think.
Well, amen. Travel safely. God bless you. And Lehigh will be here when you get back. Amen. We promise. We promise to be here when she gets back. Amen. So let us sing today and praise the Lord with her and with the praise team. I might even join in if I can get my sermon to download. So give me a minute. I'll be with you.
Amen. Amen. We're going to be laying down a few things down by the riverside. And then we're going to be doing a few other things at the riverside. You know, we have to do the dress rehearsal. Okay. So let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
I'm going to lay down my burden down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside. I'm going to lay down my burdens down by the riverside. I'm going to study war no more. Well, I ain't going to study war no more. Ain't going to study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I'm gonna lay down my sword and shield down by the riverside. Down by the riverside, down by the riverside. I'm gonna lay down my sword and shield down by the riverside and study war no more. Well, I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I'm gonna try on my starry crown down by the riverside. Down by the riverside, down by the riverside. I'm gonna try on my starry crown down by the riverside. Study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. 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 I ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more. Ain't gonna study war no more.
matter or help is nigh, carest thou not that we perish? How can thou lie asleep
when torment so madly is threatening
a grave in the angry deep? The winds and the waves shall obey thy will. Peace be still, peace be still. Weather the wrath of the storms are seen, or demons or men or whatever it be. No water can swallow the ship where lies
the master of ocean and earth and sky.
Troubled, oh, when and save, I pray. Torrents of sin and of anguish sweep o'er my sinking soul. And I perish, dear Master, oh, hasten and take control.
Even the winds and the waves obey him. We know that at the name of Jesus, things happen. Storms are calmed. Our lives are turned around. The dead are raised to life. The sick is healed. And we could go on and on and on and on, and we still wouldn't have time or tongue to tell or to write of the goodness of God. But I invite you today that we get into the habit of calling on the name of Jesus. Not only when things are not going well, or maybe when only things are going well, but let us get in that habit where that is the sweetest and the most precious name to us. And so we call that name regardless, no matter what. We're going to call on the name of Jesus because there's just something about that name.
As I was
meditate throughout the week on the seriousness of this hour, I quickly realized that of my unworthy. One of the reasons is because of my sin and my own needs of confession and need of prayer and many other needs that we all can relate to. But today I will ask something different. If you allow me, I will ask that you forget about your needs. As we're looking at this list, which we all have at this hour, we'll see names on those lists. Some we do know pretty well, and some we don't. Choose the name that you would like to pray for. As you're getting yourself ready for this prayer, pick those names. Forget about your own. You know, we don't know how it feels sometimes. As for me, I only know how it feels to lose a mother. But I may not know how it is, how it feels to lose a son or a daughter. Not yet. Or a brother or a sister. So as we come, as the praise team will begin to sing, as you come to the altar, please remember those whose pain are bigger than us, than you and I pain.
There is a sweet anointing in the sanctuary. There is a burdens you have carried, for in the sanctuary God is here. He is here. He is here to break the yoke and lift the heavy burden. He is here. He is here to heal the hopeless heart and bless the broken. Come and lay down the burdens you have carried, for in the sanctuary God is here.
Father God, we come before you this morning to praise and to worship you, to honor you, because you're the great God, the God above all God. We thank you, O Lord, that we are among the living this morning. We thank you that you spare our life to see another Sabbath. We thank you for your grace and your mercy, because we are here this morning. So we pray, O God, that you come now and touch each and every one of us. Go deep down into our needs, the mess that we're creating for ourselves. Get in there, oh Lord, and fix it for us. Today we want to forget about ourselves personally, but we want to lift others, those who are going in really deep, difficult times, those who are pain is greater than all pain, the suffering that they are going through right now. Oh Lord, I pray that your spirit come now and touch them. Heal us, oh Lord. Those of us who lost a loved one, we pray, especially the family of Jean Jett, as they mourn this painful loss, we pray, oh God, that you have mercy on them. You give them strength and power to overcome this. We pray for our pastors, Pastor Campbell, his family, and sickness. We also pray for Pastor Harley and his family, his daughter. We pray that, oh God, that you strengthen them continually. You build them back up. Wherever it is right now, we pray that the Holy Spirit is with them. We also pray for many others. Brother Bonzel is here with us. We praise your name. Sister Leslie and family, oh God. She's still missing among us here. We pray that, oh Lord, that where she is right now, she feel the power of the Holy Spirit come to her right now as we're praying for her. That she feel it in a way that she haven't felt it before. So we pray also for the Downs family. Elder Bernard, we pray for them. Peter Lewis, Brother Neal's family, Dr. Hines' family, Yvette Thompson, Leslie Wonder, Gwen Ford family. The name goes on. You see the list. You know it. It's not the first time we bring the list to you. He may not be the last time. But what we believe, oh Lord, that you are in charge and you know them all, you know them all. You know what they're going through. You know the pain, you know the situation of each and every one of them and that list. So we believe, oh Lord, that you will come and you will answer our prayer. We pray also for those who's not in the list as well. Some of them is among us right now, and some are elsewhere. So we pray, oh God, that their need, our need, also be met. We pray that your will be done into our lives. We pray for Sister Carmi Williams, Sister Tom, and Sister D. We lift them up into your presence, O Lord. All of them that is in the less, and others that is not. So as we continue to worship you this morning, O Lord, we pray that your spirit come in this place and take control of this place here. We pray that whatever that going on here in this hour, in this church, may all of us feel that there is hope for tomorrow. May all of us feel really good because God is in control. So give us hope as we leave here today. Give us strength to face the uncertainty of the future. Give us power to step up and stay strong, regardless of what
will happen this week. Give us faith to believe that you are God. You are the God of all gods, and you are all gods. So we'll trust and believe in you. Help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
soundtrack. Happy Sabbath, church. We have a little time left together today. Our clock is wrong, and so I don't want to. I wonder if the gentleman up top could help me out, if they could reach that clock and move it forward for me a little bit, so I don't keep you here longer than I should. Amen. It's right about 12:30, and I start realizing about 12:45, some of your eyes start glazing over. You start thinking about that lunch you got at home, amen? But we still want to make time for the word, amen? Brother Downs and I were talking before. I received an email last night or a text. Elder Bennett had mentioned, "It is well with my soul." One of his neighbors met in a horrific car accident. Elder Barrett, his neighbor ended up in a very terrible car accident, and he was requesting prayer for them, and also that song, "It Is Well," came to mind. I wonder if you would allow me to sing that as I just prepare to bring a word today. We're going to start a series today entitled Finish. Finish. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Finish." Now, really, no, seriously, look at your neighbor, because some of y'all kind of just didn't even look him in the eye. Look your neighbor in the eye and just give them one word. Say, "Finish." We're going to begin today. I know that we have women gone for women's ministry. We have the Pathfinders gone for the Bible Bowl, our champion Bible bowlers. Amen. But you're going to give them this first message. You're going to say, "You should have been here." Amen. We know you had to go, but you should have been here. And we're going to start today. We're not going to hold back in the name of Jesus. Let me sing this song as we just ask God to dwell with us and speak with us today. When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sea below roll, whatever my life thou hast taught me to say, it is well. My sin, oh, the joy of this glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the whole. With me, it is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. One more verse. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight
the clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound, and the Lord, he shall descend, even so.
Help me sing that chorus one last time.
It is well.
Let me hear you.
It is well with my soul. It is well.
Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, verse 24 is the one we read, but we're going to go back a little bit. Is that all right? Amen. I just want to be in his presence. How about you? And so I know they fixed the clock now. They fixed it, and it shows we don't have much time, but God can take a few minutes and make much out of it. Amen. And so just bear with me. We have a series that we're doing entitled Finish. Finish. And I'm praying that by time is over with, there's only six parts to it. Six parts to it. And the first part today is we need to dialogue and discuss on what finish is and why we don't finish. Amen? It's not a trick question. There's no quizzes or tests at the end. I just want you to pay attention. Is that all right? Because the church of God has some work to do. And if we don't finish the work, hello? I wish I had a witness in his house today. If we don't finish the work, who's going to do the work? The Bible tells me the rock's going to cry out. I don't want the rocks taking my place, hello? God's going to have enough rocks in the kingdom, hello? I want to be in the kingdom, and I want to proclaim, and I want others that don't know about the saving grace of Jesus, the saving power of Jesus, to be in his kingdom as well. So we're going to look at Acts chapter 20. I'm going to look it around here, deciding where I'm going to actually start it. I'm going to go back a little bit to verse 22. We'll just start there. Matter of fact, let's go back. Verse 19, all right? Verse 19 and forward. Let's push back to 19. Amen. Verse says, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with tears and temptation which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews. Come on now. The people that were supposed to be God's people fell on this man. They lied in wait. Come on now. They were ready to set him up. He said, and how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you. I shared everything that you needed to know. I shared with you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks, repentance toward God. Did you get that? Testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks, repentance toward God. And what's that other word? Faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. We need repentance. Come on now. Toward God. Let me tell you something. If God showed up in some of our presence, come on now. No, God is holding back some, you know, because if his glory really shined through, some of us would just burn up on the spot. I said us. Don't some of y'all looking at me, why he judging? I said us. If God's glory just came and just shined completely, but God says, look, Paul is saying, look, I testify both to the Jews and to the Greeks, repentance towards God. We got to repent. Because God knows, doesn't he know? Your neighbor might not know, or they might, but God knows. And faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. You got to have some faith. You need to have some faith in Jesus, the one that did it for you. Come on now. Jesus did it for me. Oh, y'all are a rough crowd today. Loosen up. Loosen up. Y'all too serious. Come on now. He says now in verse 22, now behold, I go bound in the spirit into Jerusalem, not knowing all the things that shall befall me there. I'm tied up. I'm bound. I'm going to Jerusalem. I don't know what's going to happen. Save, I know this, though, that save that the Holy Ghost, come on now, witnesses in every city saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. I know that I'm coming. The Holy Spirit has already told me I'm going to be walking into trouble. How many of y'all would keep going if you knew that your Christian walk was going to walk you into some trouble? Some of y'all would sign off. You'd say, okay, I'm just going to leave church for this period of time right here, you know, and then maybe wait till my trouble passes, then I'll come back to the Lord. No, come on now. We need some saints that are in it no matter what. I didn't even plan to put that there. Yeah, we need some saints that say, no matter what befalls me, I trust God. Save the Holy Ghost. I don't know what's going to happen, but what I do know is the Holy Ghost has witnessed this in every city. I can't get that word, but y'all know that word. Witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions await me, abide me. That's what that word abide means there. Let's keep going now. Verse 24, but none of these things move me. I'm just making sure y'all are here with me. Y'all here with me? We don't have a lot of time. Paul says, but none of those things move me. Some of us, we don't need much to move us. It just takes somebody to say something mean in church. And you know, some folks just setting you up. They already know how you are. They already know what upsets you. They already know how to get you shaken so you can't hear nothing that the Lord has to say to you. Paul said, none of these things move me. I already expect these things. Neither count I my life dear unto myself so that I might finish, there's that word, that I might what? Finish my course with what? Joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. I tell you all about his mercy. I have more stories than I could tell you in a lifetime about his mercy, but I need to start telling you about his grace. And in order to tell you about his grace, I've got to experience his grace. I can tell you about his mercy. I am an expert. That, we're going to stop there in this scripture. Just hold that off on the side somewhere. We've got to finish. God wants us to finish our course with what? With joy. I don't need some Christians that are finishing their course all sour mouth, all mad with God. Whoa, whoa. I need some Christians that know what they believe. I need some Christians that actually open up the Word of God and know what the Word of God says. And I need those Christians to realize that God is calling us not to be bumps on a pew, but he's calling us to finish a great work that he has prepared beforehand. Some of y'all don't believe that. Let me tell you something. God set everything up. God has set you up. God has set you up. God has set us up in a way that we can do some amazing things when we put our minds to it. When we decide to unite our minds, God says you all will do some things. But I need you. But God, he said, I need you to understand this concept of finish, because we take this word finish. So allow me to teach for a moment. Let's go to Genesis chapter 2. Let's go to Genesis 2. Genesis chapter 2, my favorite book of the Bible, because it's the first book. Amen. I just love for God. How does it go again? Let's see. In the beginning, God created the heavens. I just love that. Don't you just love that? And you know, it depends on if James Earl Jones does it, you know. Praise the Lord. Genesis chapter 2, verse 1, it reads, thus the heavens and the earth were what? Finished. I'm just wondering, what did God finish? Did God finish? Did God finish what he was up to? So look, it says, I want to read it again. Thus the heavens and the earth were what? Finished. You didn't have nothing to do with it. Turn to your neighbor and say, you didn't have nothing to do with it. All the birds, some of them that y'all like to eat. I say y'all because I didn't want to include myself. I just watched Game Changers and I'm having a moment. I'm not sure if I'm going to eat meat anymore. I'm having a moment. I'm probably going to have some oxtail today, but praise the Lord. I'm having a moment. Right? Some of those goats that some of us like to eat and chase around. Come on now. Not now. Some of those mangoes on the tree. Some of those papayas. Anybody growing papayas, please save one for the pastor. Amen. And Pastor Hoylett will look out for him too. Amen. But God finished. The Bible says, let me say it again. I just love this. I just love the poetry of this. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished and all the host of them. And on the seventh day. I can't even get y'all Adventists excited when I say, and on the seventh day. I mean, y'all should at least, somebody should say, hallelujah for the seventh day. Because if not, this world would work you 7 days a week and you wouldn't get a break. And on the seventh day, they got excited up on the stage. Thank you. Thank you, Sister Reddit. Come on, Doctor. Come on now. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created that he made. I'm going to stay right there for a minute. God finished his work. What about Jesus? Did Jesus finish his work? Are you sure? Come on, y'all. What scripture y'all thinking about? Y'all only thinking about the one where he said it is finished, right? Let's go to John chapter 17, verse 1 through 4. John 17. Stay with me now. You still with me? I'm gonna preach in a second. We're gonna preach in a minute. John chapter 17, verses 1 through 4. All right. These words spake Jesus. I like to have it in my Bible too. I can't trust technology all the time. Nothing against the technology, people. John 17, verse 1 through 4, these words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said what? Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy son, and that thy son also might what? Glorify thee. Don't miss that. Don't let that go by you. It says, Lord, he says, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy son. Uh-huh. It's okay to ask God to glorify you. Come on now. Glorify thy son, that thy son may also glorify thee. Oh, Jesus is talking to his father now. He knows what is about to go down. Watch this now. It's in verse 2. It says, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life. Give what? Eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And who is God given? Who is God given to Jesus? He just gave Pastor Campbell. Some of y'all... For all of us. Are you with me? Let's keep going. Keep going. Verse 3, it says, and this is eternal life, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. That they might know thee, the only true God. We have too many gods today. Oh, I wish I had time. We got the God of CNN. We got the God of Instagram. And boy, folks are sacrificing themselves on that gram, on that IG. You got the God of Facebook. I mean, it's telling you what to do now. The algorithms have got you hooked. If it start dinging in church, you can't even, you got to check it out, because maybe it's a friend that's gone live at another church, whatever your reason is. Can I keep going? Ooh, verse 4. I just like verse 4. It says, I have glorified thee on the earth. I have what? Huh? Y'all not, I can't hear you. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gave me to do. So did God finish? Did Jesus finish? Come on, liven up now. Did God finish? Did Jesus finish? I was talking to my parents this morning about the zombies in church. That's a whole nother sermon. Pastor told me, stay on title. So God finished, Jesus finished. I want you to understand, finish is a command, brothers and sisters. When Jesus finished, the Bible says he did what? He glorified the Father. If we want to glorify the Father, because the Father has already taken care of salvation for us. Do you believe that? If you believe you're saved, raise two hands. And some of y'all are scared to raise a hand. I'm not going to call nobody. I'll put your hand down. I don't want nobody looking at nobody funny. But see, my own mother, for decades, she used to say, you know, I'm nervous about my soul salvation. I'm just waiting in the balance, and I just pray that God will save me. And so I had to, you know, you got to wait till you get a little older because you don't want to swallow any teeth. And when I got that first opportunity to say to my mother, I said, Mom, are you telling me that you're not certain of your soul salvation in Jesus Christ? She says, well, son, you know, I'm working it out with fear and trembling. I said, hold up, Mom. My Bible tells me that whom the Son is free indeed. And it tells me if I believe in Jesus Christ, I shall be saved. Not I might be saved, I might have to wait a little time. I might have to be wretched a little longer, y'all. Come on now. But this wretched man, oh, wretched man am I, who shall save me from this body of sin is Christ Jesus. I wonder if folks started realizing that they're actually saved, maybe they'll start living like saved people. But see, that's a trick we play on ourselves when we're not confident in our soul salvation in Jesus took care. We talked about it the other week. Is Jesus only necessary or is he sufficient? Let's keep going. Some of y'all need to chew on that. We're going to come back to that. I'm going to touch on that another time. Finishes the command. If we want to glorify the Father, he is taking care of salvation in Christ Jesus. Jesus finished his work. Come on now. Jesus didn't half do it. Jesus didn't half bake it. Jesus got up on that cross and he took those nails for you and me. And he represented you and me and our children and our grandchildren and our parents and our grandparents. Some of y'all gonna get it soon. Here we go. We have to finish what we've been called to do if we're gonna glorify God. Lehi, do you wanna glorify God? And so let's look at this thing a little closer, and then we can take it home today. Man's version of finishing something is different from God's way of finishing. Did you pick that up? Come on now, when men and women, we finish things, that means we bring it to an end. We bring it to like a conclusion. It's over. When a marriage is finished, come on now. Nobody knows what I'm talking about? Huh? When you are finished with that joker, yeah? Somebody says, speak it. Somebody said, done. Yeah. When you finish a car, come on now. When you finish that car, come on, Brother Tiller. When you just squeeze that last little bit of life out of that car is finished. It's done. It can't continue. That's man's way of finishing things. Man will come through like a locust and just take every little bit of you. But God's way of finishing is different than man's way of finishing. When God finishes something, are you with me today? When God finished the earth, let's talk about that. When God finished the earth, he finished it in such a way that we could enjoy the earth. Anybody has enjoyed the earth? I told you, I love to travel, and I've seen some beauties. I've sat on the Indian Ocean in Africa on the coast there, and I've sat by palm trees that make any palm tree you've seen in Florida look like a twinkle. And I watched as the waves crash in as I was sitting there enjoying a nice chicken meal. Come on now. No, it was not veggie. God finished the earth. When God finished the earth, let me tell you, brothers and sisters, when he finished the earth, he made it so that we could be fulfilled in the earth. The earth will take care of us if... Well, I wasn't about to go all humanist on y'all. Because that's what they're selling us now. That's a whole nother topic. And so the purpose of this series is for us to understand what it means to finish. I just wanted to give that to you today. And I'm going to give you the first thing as to why we don't finish before we close today. But let me read a little bit more. Is that all right? It says the purpose... We need to call out the negative attributes and effect of not finishing things God's way. We finish a lot of things man's way, even in church. When we don't agree with somebody, we just go ahead and finish it off. There's people in church that aren't talking to people right now. I found out, you know, I was going to mention the name Kobe Bryant. I'm not a big fan, but I'm sad for his family. And I found out that he was estranged from his mother and father and members of his family for over 20 years because they were selling his high school memorabilia. When in our world, when we're finished, we just cut people off. We just end things. We just walk away from things. We'll walk away from bills. Come and some folks say, amen. I'll leave him with all those bills. Amen. Don't say it too loud. Don't hurt his feelings. We have to call out these negative mindsets and behaviors that have crept into the church in order so that we can finish important responsibilities. I need you to write these three things down. You have a pen, put it in your smartphone. We need to finish important responsibilities. We need to finish important matters. And we need to finish important opportunities. Did you get those three? Do I need to say it again? We need to finish important responsibilities. Come on, Lehi. Y'all are a smart bunch. Let me tell you something. I'm telling y'all, I know we could jump into hyperdrive together. Well, at least I believe that. Amen. We need to finish important responsibilities, important matters, and important opportunities. Let me explain those three real quick. Important responsibilities, meaning responsibilities that are ordained by God. We have a responsibility to our families. Hello? We have a responsibility to our families. Don't allow the world to have your attention so that you are not taking care of your responsibilities to your families. Hello? Some of you have accepted responsibilities within the body of Christ. And let me tell you, ain't nothing better than a deacon and an usher that loves to deek and loves to ush. And an elder that loves to eld. Y'all know that was coming, right? There are responsibilities that we've been given that have been ordained by God, things that we need to do, that we ought to do. And if we say that we love God, and if we say that we believe that he saved us from our sins and he's done all the work necessary for salvation, then what we're called to do was what we saw in Acts chapter 20. We're called to finish this. And what finishing this looks like is having faith. Through his grace. Let me keep going. Important responsibilities. So we know the things we ought to do. We need to finish those things. And finish them in a way that even after we are gone. Hello? That thing is able, Brother Joe, that thing is able to keep going on. Amen? That we take on those responsibilities in such a way that if we died, our families could keep going. Hello? We talked about this on Sunday, right? We need to have some insurances in place. We need to have our paperwork in order. Because we don't need to leave the burden on those who we leave behind. But there's some of us, we don't finish nothing. We do it like the world. We just start doing stuff, and we only half do it. Stay with me now. We talked about important responsibility. We talked about important matters, meaning matters. Write this down. Matters that are necessary for success. If we start the process of getting out of debt, we need to finish the process of getting out of debt. Don't stop halfway through. If you set your mind to something, see that thing through. Because on the other side of that something that you're working on the other side of that matter is a blessing that will give you rest. Maybe for you it's not getting out of debt. Maybe as parents, we need to start, finish taking care of our estates, as we talked about this past Sunday. Start and finish the process of improving our health. I don't know how many times I've started focusing on losing weight, and then I run into a Reese's Peanut Butter Cup. Snicker bars. A Dr. Pepper. I know, right? Adventists are like, oh my goodness, Dr. Pepper, that has caffeine in it. When are we going to become wise stewards of the things of life? And so those are important matters that we need to tend to. And I know in your mind you're thinking of those important matters that you need to tend to. Yes, brothers and sisters, we need to put some focus in it and get it finished. I remember one time when we lived in California, just a sidebar, we lived in California, and I said I was going to tile our kitchen. Now, that's an important matter. Hello? wives. I said I was going to tile the kitchen. And 6 months later, my wife was still walking on a bare floor with two or three tiles. Every time I got down on my knees, I start complaining, this is hard work. And she kept saying, hire somebody, hire somebody. And I said, no way, I'm going to do this. And I finally did it. It took me another 6 months. It seemed like I was going at a fancy speed of two tiles a day. There's some matters, though, that we need to finish. And here's this one. We need to finish when it comes to opportunities. So we got to remember, opportunities don't come around often. When we had the opportunity to buy this land, what did we do? We piped up and we bought that land. Amen? And that land is paid for, isn't it? I'm pointing this way. Is it this way? And we got some land on this side, too. I heard we have about 9 acres here. And so when the opportunity came, we took it, because opportunity doesn't come often. Opportunities are not always present. So when opportunities come up, we should want to complete them, because those are the things that help us to get ahead in life. And do you believe that God wants us to even get ahead in this life? Some of y'all, I don't think some of y'all believe that. This is not a prosperity message. This is a factual message, that when God finishes something, he sets it up with excellence. He sets it up and he perfects it. God sets it up and he sets it up in such a way that it can continue on. And he's given us the ability to do the same. Anybody here ever miss an opportunity? I'm the only one. Nobody here has missed an opportunity? I'm talking about a real, like, one that burned the pocket opportunity. I remember 2013, I was working with Pastor Phipps. And Pastor Phipps, he gave me many opportunities. He took me on TBN, Praise the Lord. So I was on, that was my first time on real Christian television. And it was a long, he gave me 20 minutes. I had, like, the spotlight. I was on there with Shaquille O'Neal's mother and Willie Jolly. I don't know if you know that name, the motivational speaker and singer. And he gave me the spotlight, and he asked me questions. And I came out of there, I said, thank you, Lord, for the opportunity. And then he opened up other opportunities for me. And I came up with this concept called Giving Option. It was a website that people could give, kind of like crowdfunding like that. And he said, I like that name. He says, you know what? I'm really close with the Salvation Army, the heads of the Salvation Army. He said, why don't we turn that into the electronic kettle for the Salvation Army? He said, you know, the Salvation Army collects $42 million a year in those red kettles outside of Walmarts and Targets. He said, why don't we take Giving Option and turn it? They're looking for something like this. What, can you think you can build it? I said, I believe I can. We flew out there. I stayed up all night, went up to upstate New York, stayed up all night, put together this presentation, and the Lord had blessed. We had some engineers from one of the largest cloud computing companies and data storage companies sent their two top engineers to speak in the meeting, and we got in the meeting, and the heads of the, you know, they came in uniforms and very official, and we sat up in this beautiful conference room, and I began to present, and when I was done, they said, where do we sign? And they were signing to 10%. Our company would have received 10% of every donation that was given to the Salvation Army through that electronic kettle. They said, where do we sign? Where's the legal paperwork? Where are the contracts? We're ready to go. And we were like, Weeks turned into months. We didn't finish. Months turned into a year, and they had all but given up hope. And I called Pastor Phipps one day to apologize to him and say, Pastor, I'm sorry that I couldn't finish that assignment, that I couldn't finish that fulfilling that opportunity. And he used the word I hadn't heard before. I had heard before, but it had never been used on me. He said, Andre, I am chagrined. That was pretty bad, wasn't it? God wants us to finish, because there are opportunities that are right here in front of his people right now if we would just wake up. I've got to let you go home today. Either we're going to learn lessons, as I've said before, or we're going to learn to suffer loss. Either we're going to learn lessons or we're going to learn to suffer lack. We must learn to finish, church, so we need to know what helps us to finish. And so write this next one down. Finishing requires motivation. Finishing requires motivation. We said Jesus was motivated to finish. Why was Jesus motivated to finish? Because he loved you and me. He finished the work of salvation. He was motivated to give us eternal life, and he didn't do a half job. He did a whole job. God was motivated to finish creating the earth, to get it into a condition, I said, so that we could enjoy it, to make it a place where we could be fulfilled. And so when we talk about finish, we're talking about the fact that in order to achieve fulfillment, are you hearing me today? In order to achieve fulfillment in life, we must learn to finish. I talked about finishing believing that we're saved. Let me ask that question now. How many of you believe that you're saved? Some of us need to be finished with the concept of being saved so that we can start living in the things that God has called us to do instead of being busy, worried about our salvation. I'm not worried about my salvation. People don't finish school oftentimes because we're not motivated to finish. Did I tell the truth? Barring illness or a true lack of opportunity, we are often motivated by other forces. Maybe it's a cute girl that got our attention, and we don't finish school. Maybe it's that cute guy that got your attention, and you decide you want to run off into the stars with him. There are many reasons why people don't finish, but lack of motivation is one of the major reasons. Some of us stayed in school and paid tuition, but we didn't pay attention. We studied just enough to pass our exams, but not enough to understand how the world really works. We've got to learn how to finish. So I want to close today. What should motivate all of us to finish is that we want to lead a productive life. How many of you want to lead a productive life? Or you just want to stay like you are? And anybody just want to see, you just want to keep it just like it is right now? Pastor, I don't want to change nothing. I want to keep it just like it is. But God has more for you, brothers and sisters. And if we finish, the number one thing about finishing is that when we do finish, we have a period of rest. We can actually enjoy the thing that we have. We're going to be talking about it. So before we go today, simply I want the number one reason why we don't finish. We talked about not being motivated, but the reason that we're not motivated is because something has got our attention. So the number one reason why we don't finish is because we allow ourselves to be distracted. Somebody knew that. We allow ourselves to be distracted. We're going to be going into the story of Nehemiah in the coming weeks. As we continue to go down into this, we want to point out in there, because in that story, which we just did in our Sabbath school lesson, we will be able to see how Nehemiah was able to finish the work that he set out to do. And the first thing he did is he didn't allow himself to be distracted by the naysayers. There's going to be people that have agendas for your life. Don't get distracted. Hello? I'm talking to a young man. I'm talking to a young lady. There's going to be people that have agendas for your life. I'm talking about somebody that's on a job. There's people that have an agenda for your life. Don't live your life by somebody else's agenda unless it's God's agenda. So number one, we don't finish because we allow ourselves to be distracted. I want to end today. I want to ask the team to put up a picture on the screen. What does that look like? Somebody said, looks like me. Yeah, that's me. Looks like a mugshot, right? Yeah? No, that was right here in Florida. That's right here in Polk County. Yeah? It says, warrant, required bond. How much I had to pay to get out? How much? That's me. Somebody said, it looks like you, though. They kind of got my name twisted around. I guess I don't know what that was all about. But the story behind this began, I believe it was August, I came to preach at Lehigh, August of 2015. I came to preach at Lehigh. Anybody remember that? I even remember the sermon I preached on that day. I preached about Saul going to see the witch of Endor because he wanted to visit Samuel. And I started talking about all the things that we as Christians, we still believe a lot of foolishness, right? A lot of, you know, right? And I got in my car, a car that I was driving, I should say, a car that I was transporting for a friend from Georgia to Florida, and I was driving that car back home to St. Petersburg, where I lived. and had a great time with you. Always had a wonderful time. Had a great lunch. You know, my belly was full, and the hammer was down. I got to Sarasota County, came over the hill, and the state trooper was sitting in the middle lane. And I mean, it didn't matter if I came off the gas pedal. That thing just kept on going. He jumped out and he pulled me over, and he didn't arrest me. Mm-mm. You know, he just literally said to me, "Sir, license and registration," and then he began to say, "This car has paper plates, and the date is almost expired." He said, "And this is a Georgia thing." He said, "This car should be registered in the state of Florida." I said, "I just brought it into Florida." I said, "I literally drove into Florida, went to preach at a church, got a suit on, right? Praise God for a suit every once in a while, amen." And I said, I literally was like, "You know, sir, this car is registered under the dealer. It will be registered in Florida soon as I turn it over to the person." He said, "What you're telling me is, by your own account, you're driving a car that is not registered in the state of Florida." I said, "No, sir, I'm not." He said, "I could tow this car. I could send you to jail. All this stuff." He said, "But I'm going to write you a ticket. Matter of fact, you know how they get it. I'm not going to write you a ticket for 96. That's how fast I was going. He said, "I'm going to write you a ticket for 85. He said, "But you got to come to court." He said, you can pay for the ticket. And he did say, "You got to come to court," but I didn't catch on to why he said I had to come to court. And so I paid the ticket. I thought it was over with. And November 5th, I believe it was, if that's a Sunday, I was heading to Palm Bay from St. Pete to a funeral of a friend's wife who had died from cancer. And I was on the program. I was fully suited and booted. I had my family in the car. I had my mother-in-law in the car. And I was overtaking a minivan. Couple months later now, I had been hanging out with y'all, had a good time, love you guys, great, everything. Overtaking a minivan in the right lane, mistake number one, got up to 90-something miles an hour in the overtaking process, slowed down, but right at Polk County, and if anybody knows the 4 really well, at the exit 44 where they were building the overpass at the time, they had 5 or 6 state troopers staked out with one, what do they call those, a speed trap? And they pull me over along with a bunch of other cars. I said, "Okay, it's not racial profiling, you know, because every time you get pulled over, oh, they pulled me over because I was a black man." No, I was speeding. We're sitting there for an hour. Everybody else is taking off. And finally, after everybody else is gone, another state trooper vehicle pulls up, and this guy looked a little more official. And he stepped out, put on his hat, and he walked up. He said, "Mr. Campbell, please step out of the vehicle. Mr. Campbell, please step to the rear of the vehicle. Mr. Campbell," anybody know this drill right here? "Mr. Campbell, please step into the grass." Anybody? I'm the only one? I'm the only one?
Never been there. Never done that.
So I need to warn you then. Uh-huh. It don't feel good, right? Uh-huh. I've been watching a lot of YouTube videos, so y'all know I was scared. I was like, "Lord." And he stepped further into the grass. I was like, "Okay." He said, "One more step." I'm like, "Okay." He said, "Please put your hands behind your back." I said, "Okay." And I was like, okay. And click, click, clink, clink. My wife jumped out the car. They're like, "Get back in the car." I'm like, "But this is impossible. This cannot be happening." He said, "Oh, it's happening." I said, "Well, what is it about?" He said, "You have a warrant." I said, "Where?" He said, "Sarasota County." And I thought of y'all. I said, "I shouldn't have preached at that church that day." I said, "But I paid the ticket." He said, "But you didn't finish. You didn't read the ticket, did you?" I said, "But I paid the ticket. I have it in my dash box." And my wife went and got it out the dash box. And I said, "The ticket is paid." And I'm getting scared now, y'all. He said, "You failed to appear in court." I said, "What?" He said, "The officer didn't tell you that driving without a registration in the state of Florida is a criminal offense. It's a misdemeanor, and you must appear in court to answer why you were driving or prove that you weren't driving without a registration." And I said, "I didn't know that." He said, "Well, knowing is not a defense." He said, "We're taking you to jail." You got to come back next week to hear the written. No, I'm not going to do it. I won't be here next week. I'm preaching at Southern Adventist University. Stephen Ayers is the one that gave my name up. So thanks, Stephen. I won't be here next week, but I'll be back and we'll finish this. But I'm going to finish the story for you. I ended up, let me tell you, God, I'm so glad I can still live on his mercy even when, because it was my fault. I had the responsibility to read that ticket. I had the responsibility to show up in court. But I was too busy, distracted with other things of life, that I wasn't taking care of the matters. Hello? Remember we talked about we need to finish the matters? And let me tell you something. When them officers lock those things on your hand, you're going to the county jail. Come on now. It was a 45-minute drive with my hands behind my back. Circulation was cutting off. And if you've never been in handcuffs, they got a little metal piece that sticks out in the handcuff to make sure you don't misbehave. I still feel that. I still have phantom pain. Like 5 years later, I still got phantom pain. And we get to the jailhouse there in Polk County. Hello? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Polk, look it up. And I'm there in Polk County, and I get in there, and God says, son, he says, you have not been paying attention. I've been trying to get your attention. You've been living on mercy, and you haven't been finishing the work that I have given you to do. There's some work that I got for you down in Lehigh. Come on now. I didn't even know about it then. And I get inside, and the ladies, you know, the good old church ladies are back in behind the bulletproof glass, you know. They took my picture. They say, oh, what a handsome mugshot. The first one I was smiling, they said, Pastor, you cannot smile in your mugshot. And this thing started really sinking in. And they said, you know, they should have given you professional courtesy as a pastor. They should have let you go to the funeral because you don't have a record. They should have let you turn yourself in after you went to the funeral. And they said, so, you know, because of that, we're not putting you with general population. I said, okay. God started working already because God said, I just want to get your attention. You're not going to have to go through a cavity search. Y'all not hearing me, huh? I'm talking about God, a God that is real. And let me tell you something. The Bible tells me that for we know that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord. Even when you are off drifted and distracted and getting caught up in foolishness and not taking care of matters and responsibilities and taking advantage of opportunities that God has for you, God still has a way of working things out. He said, no, I'm not going to let you suffer that. Didn't have to put on the orange. I mean, I look good in orange. I look good in orange, but he said, not that orange. Hello? He said, you're not going, my ushers got on orange today, and y'all look great in orange, but God said, not today, buddy. They did put me in a cage in the middle of a room. I mean, inhumane nonetheless, hello? I mean, literally a box cage that I could stand like a gorilla and look all around, and a little metal seat to sit on. And then shortly after that, they put me in the pre-release, and when I found I had to pay $2,000 for bail, it wasn't, you know, anybody here know about bail? Some of y'all act like y'all don't know nothing about bail. They're supposed to pay like 10%, but they must have changed the law because they said you got to pay the whole $2,000. And guess what? Pat said, y'all didn't give me $2,000 as my honorarium. Had to call daddy. Uh-huh. Daddy paid the $2,000. Hallelujah for parents. I don't know how y'all do it. Y'all just parents be having money hiding all over the place. Y'all from the Great Depression? Yeah? Had to call daddy, bailed me out. But before I bailed out, I realized God still took that situation. God still took my drifting. God still took my distraction, and he used it for his glory. As I was in the pre-release cell, and let me tell you something, that place is sterile. It's nasty, but it's sterile. Metal. Just silver metal, shining metal everywhere. The bed bunk was metal. The pillow was metal. The toilet was next to the sink. And they brought you pork bologna sandwiches and milk. And I was in there by myself enough to look around and realize, I said, Lord, this is not my purpose. At 40-something years old, I don't need ever to again have handcuffs on my hands. Come on, I'm talking about waking up, y'all. I'm talking about realizing I need to, there's some things I need in my life that I need to finish. I need to get back, and I need to finish becoming a pastor. I need to finish becoming a father. And I've done a pretty janky job, but I got to finish becoming a husband too. God sent to close it all off that day. He sent a young man, 18 years old, who was being released with me, young Caucasian young man. And in 2 minutes, he wanted to make sure, when he found out I was a pastor, because I wasn't trying to tell him, but they'd already told him, you're going in the pre-release with a pastor. You know, why do you have to do that? Because people either get holy or hellish. He said, I want you to know I'm an atheist. But see, he didn't know this Pastor Campbell. See, Pastor Campbell, I wasn't about to take him on. We just talked. We talked about life, and he began to open up. And I realized that God said, son, I'm going to show you I can use you almost, I could use you in any situation. He said, but I need you to start focusing. I need you to make up your mind that you're going to finish the work that I've given you to do. And he said, even in the prison house, I'm going to give you work to do. And by the time we were done there that day, by the time I was released from that pre-release cell and said goodbye to him, he said, hey, can I get your number? Can I be your friend on Facebook? And about 6 months or 7 months later, the young man reached out to me on Facebook. He said, you know what? I believe. Amen. Amen. And all I had told him was, all I told him was why I believe. That was the day I woke up, y'all. That was the day that God arrested my attention. And he said, son, the distractions of this life must end. My time is gone. But I wonder if there's somebody here today that says, Pastor, I hear you, and this series has got my attention. There's some things in my life I need to finish. But first, before you come back and hear part two, I need you to go home. I need you to go to your the places that you go, and I need you to remove the distractions from your life. Some of us, it's other people that have us distracted. We're too busy looking at them. We don't like what they're doing in church. And so as the musicians play and we close, I wonder, again, I'm asking for early adopters. I'm asking for people who get it already. You see where we're going with this. We've got a work to do. We need to figure out we need to get our finger on the pulse of what's going on in Lehigh, not just Lehigh Church, because there are people hurting in Lehigh Church. Amen? Are there people hurting in Lehigh Church? Are there people in need in Lehigh Church? Uh-huh. Are there people in need? Oh, everybody's good? Huh? We don't all need the same things, but we have needs. Is our community a community that there's things we could do to help that community? We need to make up our mind to finish, but the first thing we need is to not be distracted. Anybody says, Pastor, I'm ready to finish. And so I'm going to remove all the distractions. If that's you, I want you to get up from your seat and come down and join with me today. Just get up out your seat. Just get up out your seat. Just come on down. Come on, just join with me. Say, Pastor, I'm ready to finish. Somebody say, yeah, finish the sermon, Pastor. Finish the sermon. But if you're saying, no, I want to finish, I'm going to bypass the distractions. I'm going to bypass the agendas, and I'm going to push forward in God to finish the matters and the responsibilities and take advantage of the opportunities that come before me as a child of God. I want to finish. If that's you, why don't you get up out of your seat and just come and join with me? I've got some first adopters. I've got some first adopters. God finished. Whatever God does is perfect. Jesus finished. Are you going to finish? I'm determined to finish. Let us pray. Father, for far too long, the church has been distracted. Politics, discord, disagreements, preferences, beliefs. Lord, we've flogged each other with the word many times. When you've been calling us out to finish the work that you've set before us. And Lord, we've been called like Christ to glorify you, Lord. How else can we glorify you? Lord, I believe we've been putting you to shame. But Father, today we're taking the first step. We're not going to live distracted any longer, Lord. Lord, we're going to pay attention to the responsibilities that you've placed before us, our children, our families, our responsibilities we've taken on within the body of Christ, Lord. Father, Lord, we're going to finish the matters that you've put in front of us, Lord. And Lord, the beauty of it is when we finish these things, Lord, we will find rest for our souls, Lord. The church will be comforted and encouraged that it will go on, that another generation understands what this is all about. They don't think we just come to a box each week and sit down and sing songs and stand up and sit down and pray and give money and leave. They actually know, Lord, what we're here to do. They know the mission. They know the vision. Lord, give us a heart to finish, but remove the distractions from around us. Father, we ask this today and forevermore as we begin this journey to learn how to finish. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Please be seated.
Drawing near, but when they prayed for deliverance, the victory would begin. It's when you call upon the Lord, He summoned all of heaven. So pray on, for you are who the Lord is looking for. Pray on, for this will tear those mighty strongholds down. Stay on your knees, for this is where the mountains run. Very soon you'll win the
Amen. Let the church say amen. Please remember this evening at 5:15 we will have youth forum. We invite you to come back out where we can continue our dialogue and pray for our Pathfinders as they go to Bible Bowl. Is this the championship? No. Not yet, but we know they're going to do well. Praise the Lord.
God has spoken, let the church.